This was 3 extra screens, but it really had like a positive impact.
Every product should understand like what method and which discount strategy works for them the best. The first one was how we can increase our LTV. So far, we see like a 4% increase in monthly recurring revenue.
You cannot really sell any cent to the person that does not come back to the product. Revenue and the way you monetize also hugely impacts acquisition and retention as well.
The only case I think you want to do a hard paywall is when you have a huge cost associated with your like product.
Instead of just having one long screen, you purposefully break it into those 3 or 4.
Hi, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of Growth Mentor Live. Today, we are discussing often overlooked revenue growth levers. I'm Micah McGuire, head of content here at Growth Mentor, and today I am joined by Vahe Bagdasaryan, a senior growth marketing manager at CoinStat, and Ekaterina Gansrigle, head of marketing at MIMO. This is going to be a great session, guys. You are definitely going to have your notes prepared. We do have some slides during this session that basically are just a little bit of a visual aid to help illustrate some of our points here. But for the most part, we will have Q&A throughout the session. So if at any point during our talk you have questions, please put those in the chat. I will be keeping an eye out to pull in questions as we discuss. Also, yes, there will be a recording available. So if you are not able to join us for the entire session, you will have that in your inbox next week after our video editor has had a chance to work her magic on it. Alrighty, so with all of that, we will go ahead and get started with questions. Vahe, Ekaterina, it is great to have you both here today.
Thank you. Thanks for the invitation.
So first, I am just going to quickly blow through some context here. We're just going to take a minute or two just to make sure that everybody's on the same page at where we're at. So we are discussing revenue growth levers for B2C apps. Is this more specific to a certain vertical or a certain industry within B2C apps? Or basically, does this work for anyone who's in B2C?
I think it works for everyone. I also think the principles and the approaches, maybe even some tactics we'll discuss, are also applicable for even web-based apps and products as well. So my examples are not really limited to a specific vertical.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I also agree that most other things are applicable for all industries, but I think there could be some industry-specific differentiations, like because maybe you can see some tactics working for some specific industry and not in the other industry, because there are some industries. For example, I work in fintech, and people in fintech usually have a higher willingness to pay, so it gives you more room to play with revenue compared to some other verticals like utilities. Overall, I think most of the things Ekaterina mentioned are applicable for all industries and also can be applicable for some web-based products.
Okay, great. So Ekaterina, I think we get into this concept of fixating on like conversion optimization and paywall optimization. And do we have better ways of doing that? I think you had this slide here that we wanted to discuss.
Maybe one of my biggest issues, or like the issues that I started feeling and noticing in recent years, especially when I was reflecting on the results of the year, like for the company, you usually have the retros after every sprint. You might have like monthly, quarterly results. And it makes a lot of sense to reflect on what went well, what worked out, what did not. To be honest, in 2022 and 2023, what I noticed is that the biggest revenue drivers were not coming that much from actually improving the conversion funnel. They were coming from a lot of other inputs. This obviously makes you realize even clearer that revenue is an output metric, and there are so many more levers apart from optimizing the conversion funnel that you can use to grow. And that's why it's critically important to at least be aware of all of this. So here is an input. You can see that acquisition, activation, as well as retention, like all of this can have a significant impact on revenue, while in turn, the revenue and the way you monetize also hugely impacts acquisition and retention as well.
Right, great. Vahe, anything to add there?
Yeah, I mean, I generally agree with you, and the thing is like, what I, what I kind of noticed the same pattern. As much as you kind of improve the overall product and some other metric that regards, for example, when you improve your onboarding and optimize it, you just immediately see that it's reflecting to the revenue growth. And recently we had a similar case when we revamped our onboarding flow at CoinStat and tried to make it more personalized to address specific user goals. And we introduced this goals feature when users are like putting goals on like what they want to achieve, like their financial freedom, their investment, you know, goals, et cetera, et cetera. And it was like kind of a towards like the onboarding optimization, also to increase user activation. But on the other hand, you're seeing this, the work you do for this stuff also helps to increase the revenue and improve your revenue. And here again, you see that it's a revenue, as Ekaterina mentioned, is like an output metric. If you do all the things good and correct on other verticals like activation and the core product value improvement, etc., you can see there is an improvement in revenue too.
So I think we are going to get into a little bit about how you can kind of structure your experimentation processes and all of that in just a minute, but actually I want to jump to what are some of these non-obvious ways to grow your revenue and actually get into some of the tactics here. Katharina, we'll let you start because I think some of these are yours, right?
Yeah, I start. As Vahe also just mentioned, they worked a bit on improving the onboarding and the activation. And this was actually the case for us as well. It was not me personally working with this team. It was our core app, core product team working on improving the onboarding. Because for quite some time, I was not a strong believer that focusing on the activation rate will actually be a big driver. And we had quite a lot of discussions with our product manager about it. In the end, I was actually super surprised and happy to see that when you know something works in theory, also works in practice. And this was the case when they added, we slightly changed the onboarding and added more screens to help a user better pick, be more confident in picking the path that they're trying to learn, like the programming course that they want to learn. This was three extra screens instead of just us telling you better focus on this. It really had a positive impact not only on activation and retention rate, but also on the trial opt-in rates. And the 10% increase for a trial opt-in rate is quite a significant improvement, because sometimes you just fall into optimizing and going iterating on the changes that can maybe bring 2-5% improvements. So this was actually quite a good result. And on the next screen, I have another example from improving activation as well, with 11% improvement in trial opt-in rates. This was when we also added an extra screen for showing the user the future progress. This is quite a common approach overall, where you show the future impact you can make, how much weight you're going to lose, or how much muscle you're going to build. So this is proven that it works. We never tried it before, but by visualizing the future progress of the user, we also see quite a good improvement, not only of the activation rate, but also of the trial opt-in rates. And on the next slide, I have some more examples of this. These are from other apps, how your anxiety will decrease and how much muscle you can build or weight you're going to lose. You probably have seen all of this in health and fitness category especially. So activation was one of the big drivers recently that I personally knew works, but had a couple of examples to actually see it working.
Okay, great.
The next one was actually quite a big endeavor, and it's quite a big, complex thing to implement and to build, which is localization. I'm not going to say that everybody should localize their products. It really depends on the type of your product, on how maybe content heavy it is, where your target audience is based, where your users are coming from, and also how critical for them it is to have the product localized. Initially, the assumption was that, yeah, maybe we'll see some marginal improvements in retention in non-English speaking markets. Still, we invested this effort. We localized the app into Spanish, into Brazilian, Portuguese, Russian, French, Italian. I think that's it. German. And we actually saw huge improvements across the whole funnel. The thing about improving retention here is that you cannot really sell anything to the person that does not come back to the product, right? So by improving retention, we are increasing this amount of future touch points with the users during which we can push our subscription or premium offer or whatever, which means that this creates this flywheel. And in addition to improving retention as such, you also subsequently improve the monetization and virality as well. So the numbers that I have here on the slides was when it comes to day 7 retention or purchase rate or friend invite rates, these are like day 30 metrics, more or less. This does not even yet take into account the future effect of retention that also will be there in the future and will have a cumulative effect. And the only drawback that I should mention here is the complexity that it adds to the product, because it becomes pretty difficult to maintain for every new feature that you will be releasing from then on. You'll probably have to localize the content and your interface and everything. So that's something to keep in mind for sure.
Okay. Before we go on to 3, I actually do want to jump back just quickly to the activation example here. And basically, we got a great question on how did you identify what questions to ask at this point?
Overall, it was more of a test to begin with. We have a certain number of programming languages that we teach, and most of our users are complete beginners. So that's why not everybody who comes to the app necessarily knows how Python is different from JavaScript. And these two questions were the ones that we believed were pretty much helping the user to decide with the highest degree of confidence what path and what track would be most relevant for them.
Okay. And did you guys do, I'm assuming, some kind of user research? Did you guys have survey results for that kind of identified those as possibilities?
We did not do, we do a ton of user research. And yes, we did the research where we saw that users do struggle with picking the path. They also do struggle with deciding what language they should learn, what is the best for them. So this was the reason to improve on that and onboarding to begin with.
Okay. All right. Great. So I will go ahead and jump back to 3 here.
The third one, obviously, let's try to not forget about the distribution. Of course, I also think the term growth, when you say also we're working on growth, it can be understood very differently. And sometimes you have folks who are focusing specifically on user acquisition, which is also growth. So this is more or less what this slide is about. Apart from just paid acquisition, etc., a lot of wins we had, I think it was 2022, were connected a lot with improving the organic distributions, which is achieved by working on App Store optimization. One of the examples that you see, which I really like showing, is how we changed our screenshots. And it's a very minor change that you see on the second set on the right. Instead of saying from bite-size exercises to portfolio projects, we started mentioning the specific names of programming languages. And this has led to for this kind of an experiment, 50% improvement in conversion rates, simply because just by writing in the copy, in the title, etc., that you are teaching Python or HTML or JavaScript, is still required some mental processing, I believe, some mental power from the users. While at the same time, after putting them right into the screenshots, this really helped us to ease the visual recognition and it really led to a huge improvement, which we did not see with that many experiments before. And another thing that you can use is using custom product pages and custom store listings. These days, Google even has rolled out a new section where you can create custom store listings for search terms. This also showed like from 15 to 70% improvements to conversion to download when you customize the store listing pages. And on top of this, I also have to mention the promotional content and the featurings. If you have like the promotional content pieces or in-app events like on App Store Connect or Google Play, and they additionally get picked up for featuring, this can also have a huge impact on downloads. So this is also to say that your monetization structure, your whole conversion funnel should be optimized, and it should be obviously ready for an influx of users when something like this happens. However, again, it's not the only lever that you have, and working on distribution and improving, especially organic distribution, makes a lot of sense.
Okay. All right. Great. And we've also got a question on the previous on localization. This was mostly about just offering the content in different languages, correct? It was not anything content-wise. It was just taking and translating the same material into different.
Yeah, exactly. It was, I would split localization into two parts. Like first, so you can localize the store listings. This is roughly you can decide and test yourself if this is making sense for you, like to rank better, to drive more organic traffic, to resonate with the users better. And the second part is localizing the product. But no, apart from offering the content in the native language, we did not do much else. The reason behind it was that, as I mentioned, a lot of our users are beginners and our audience is super international. It's they're coming from all over the world. And on top of programming being surrounded by a lot of, rumors and pretty much a lot of users believe that it's not for them, that they will never be able to learn programming, that they will never become developers because it's so difficult and complicated. So this barrier to entry is already fairly high. Like users should be confident and we try to prove it with our product that they can learn to code, that everybody can. However, language was another big barrier that they had. So apart from the stereotypes and rumors, you have a second layer of, okay, I don't even speak English to be able to do that. That was the main reason why we decided to invest into this feature, because removing one of these huge barriers was was making sense for the users.
So we will go ahead and jump from App Store optimization onto your fourth lever.
The fourth is actually a section of slides about conversion funnel improvements. So while I said it's not the only lever, I still had to mention some of the tactics that that are important that can work. So one of them is the thing that is often forgotten is the paywall impression rate. We tend to measure trial opt-in rates, purchase rates, and everything from the install. So we use installs as a denominator to see how our rates are improving. And the amount of impressions that your paywalls actually get is often forgotten. It's often just not a part of the funnel that, in my experience, the professionals use to analyze. And this is why I wanted to say, don't ignore it. If your trial opt-in rate has dropped, it's still important to check if your paywall impressions have dropped because maybe your onboarding has changed. And because of this, your paywalls might not be shown as much as before. On the next slide, cashback screens. Back in the days, 3-4 years ago, it was quite a popular strategy. But then I think the stores started pretty much banning and disapproving the submissions for the apps that were using this tactic. However, I recently discovered that these days it's actually still working. So iOS is not as against, the App Store Connect is not as against the cashback screens as they used to be. So now if a user closes your paywall, let's say somewhere in onboarding, you can still follow up with a second screen on top. The key here is to make sure that these are done ethically, that they're still not like blocking the user experience, that they're not too intrusive. Apparently these days it works again.
Okay. And kind of how would you define, I guess, an ethical catchback screen? I mean, is there any kind of like principles people should be following on that front?
Yeah, I think this is pretty much the like the App Store Connect guidelines on the UI UX that you should follow. But I mean, to not, for like random example, to not make the close button absolutely invisible, to make it present. So to still stick to this for the user, to give them an option to close it and to proceed without signing up. The fourth one is the tactic that also seems like counterintuitive at first, but I like this. I like this tactic that Duolingo, I personally saw it in Duolingo first, when they started breaking down the paywalls into multiple steps, which means like instead of just having one long screen, like scrollable screen, or just one screen of a paywall. You purposefully break it into, I don't know, three or four. On one screen, they show the pro benefits, super benefits. This is how the subscription is called. On the second one, they follow up with the comparison table of how it's different from the free version. Then they try to remove your trial anxiety with telling you, we're going to send you a reminder before your trial expires. And then they finally show you the pricing plans. And this is where the purchase might happen. So again, seems counterintuitive at first, because why would you make a user click like two, three more times when they already decided maybe to proceed with your purchase anyways? But in reality, I believe that it's very valuable because on each of the screens, you're addressing each of the barriers and concerns that users might have. Like with the first one, you're explaining the value of your pro subscription. Then on the second screen, you're explaining what's the difference, why they should upgrade and not stick with the free version. Then you remove the trial anxiety and say, don't worry, we'll remind you. And then you let them choose the plan that might work best for them. So I do believe, and we also tested this, and you can also move to the next screen. Where we saw pretty also solid improvement in the trial opt-in rate. We did not go as far as having like three or four extra screens. We basically split our paywall into two screens instead. And we saw a 9% improvement in the trial opt-in rate. We were showing the benefits of the pro subscription, and at the same time, this trial anxiety removal screen, more or less, to explain how the free trial works. So it's a bit more of educational one. Pretty much the tactics that I've mentioned before, like with the paywalls, these are fairly easy to test, especially these days when there are plenty of also tools available for this specific purpose. However, what might be a much bigger issue in reality is that the value that your pro paid version offers just does not resonate with users, and it might not be enough. I think when I look at the results of the surveys where I ask why the users canceled the trial, one of the most common reasons is price. It's probably the top reason. The second one is did not get enough value from the pro offering, and the free version is good enough. So these are the type of issues that are, I believe, are harder to solve, because for this you need to really dig into user research. You need to talk to them to really figure out what kind of value they expected, what matched the expectations and what did not. And this brings me to this slide, where it's also important to understand like what are the most important drivers for your users. They differ by vertical, right? Is it about mastering a certain skills? In this sense, they might be more interested and care more about the personal stats and the progress they're making, especially, again, health and fitness, for example. Or is it about connecting with others? Is it about being able to compete together? So then you work on features like a leaderboard, and then you can also consider locking the access to this feature in order to upsell it later on, right? Here I have the examples of how the paid features for an education app can look like. But the main idea here is to understand how your user, like what your user's needs are. And based on this, you can also package your premium offering a little bit better.
Okay. And are there certain ways, I guess, because I can imagine this would be really tricky to kind of understand this motivation whenever you're talking about this kind of stuff in a user interview. Are there certain questions that you can ask to kind of get at, you know, whether somebody might be like more leaning towards the competitive side or if they're more interested in, say, like goal setting for themselves?
Yeah, for sure. I think the competitive versus individual autonomous progress is like a fairly easy thing to figure out. Like I can tell you that for our users, for example, competitive aspect is not that important. If you do 15 user interviews and maybe like in 12 out of 15, you hear that, nah, never used this feature. Actually, I'm just interested in comparing my progress to my own progress and seeing how much better I am today compared to yesterday. You also like, we also see a lot of user reviews and like survey responses, which say, I'm not interested in leaderboard. It's a lot of pressure. I don't care. I just want to make progress and learn on my own terms, right? So you just start seeing these patterns at some point, whether it's surveys or interviews. And the other things are also like, I would say that stats and the personal progress is fairly important to everyone. At least like my experience is mostly with education and health and fitness apps. And these are the verticals where the performance stats are really important in health and fitness. If we're talking about different tracking apps, and at the same time, like the personal progress, consistency, how much I've learned, how much time I've spent learning, how many like projects I've coded, like this is also super, super important for the education apps. And the last, maybe obvious to some, but the tactic that I believe you should imply after maybe having tried and already like polished a bunch of other things in your product is when you feel like you're really like hitting your ceiling of your LTV and of how much you can actually earn with one user, with one subscriber, then it might be the time to introduce some new products, new tiers, or a second option, which I personally have not tried, but which I see working and getting more and more popular, especially also on Android apps, to be fair. I think Google Play is pushing this quite heavily. It's hybrid monetization. This is when, on top of your subscription, you also start upselling individual like in-app purchases, and this helps you to get additional revenue from there and like raise the ceiling of your lifetime value for every user.
And I'm kind of curious on this one. I know a lot of times you have to be very cautious with this because whenever you start stacking on extra offers, people kind of have, you know, this point where users go, you know, oh, I'm already paying for this, yet you want me to pay more. How do you introduce these in a way that kind of, I guess, get around that to a certain extent?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, I don't have like too much experience with that. Basically, when it comes to our new product, like Mimo Max, as you can see, we started promoting it just this year, like pretty much early this year. So we're still learning a lot when it comes to this. It's indeed true that it might cause confusion and it might really be feel misleading to users because they've already paid once. And this way, like you kind of asking them to pay again for something else. In our case, it works fine because the second subscription is actually giving you access to a completely different platform, which is web. So it's like a subscription more or less for a different product, which looks different, it feels different, and it's also aimed at a much more committed, dedicated audience that want to become professional developers. I would say there are issues when it comes to what's the difference and I don't understand, I already paid, why do you log this again? Definitely see this, but not it's not that much of an issue, like at least for us in our case these days.
Okay, All right, great. I think that's an awesome answer to that question. Covered it very, very thoroughly. Alrighty, I think from here, Vahe, we are starting to get into some of your non-obvious.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay, so I'm going to present some very quick, some mini case studies that could be considered as, you know, non-obvious revenue growth strategies from my experience. And I think the strategies that I'm going to present are mostly applicable for any kind of industry, and you can just kind of take and repurpose for your own app or for your own industry, and it can be useful. So going to the first strategy, there is this cart abandonment rate. I mean, when we talk about like cart abandonment rate, we mainly think about e-commerce, right? When you go to some e-commerce store and you want to buy something, you add it to your cart, you don't check out, and you receive an email immediately. Like, hey, this item is in your, you know, cart, and then you got a discount to purchase, to check it out, et cetera, et cetera. This is like similar to the like the catch-up screen that Katrina showed earlier, but it's just kind of different from how we approach this. So when we're looking at our data, we notice that a lot of users are clicking in the like a start free trial button or continue button, and then this Apple's native integration sheet opens when they need to face ID and make the payment, and they would like just decline it and didn't, you know, go further to make the purchase. And when we look at this ratio, it's like, okay, there is a big drop off here, and like how we can like address this issue to improve the revenue and the subscriptions. And we come up with a, like a, this card, like this abandonment offer, and it would trigger on a paywall when somebody would click on the start free trial and then cancel the confirmation dialogue. And then, as you can see in the like screenshot, the gift or the pop-up would appear and say, you know, we are giving you a discount if you check out now, check out this moment. I mean, and we saw a pretty much like a success with this. In general, we saw what, like 64% increase in transaction complete and transaction start ratio, which is clicking on the start free trial button and completing the transaction, and 10% increase in a new revenue. So if you don't kind of track this ratio, I think it's a good shot to just see, you know, what is your ratio for abandonment, and how you can kind of employ similar tactics to improve that. Going forward to the next strategy, this is, we use like lifecycle marketing heavily in the in optimizing monetization and doing retargetings. Lifecycle, for people who don't know, lifecycle marketing is the all CRM communication that users are getting based on directions. It includes the it includes push notifications, email, in-app messages, SMS, pretty much any channel that you have. And we have kind of a different lifecycle marketing series based on the user journey. When somebody takes a free trial, we start sending them the trial nurture campaigns, which aims to explain them the value of the subscription and why they should why they should keep it. If somebody subscribes to premium, they start to receive a premium, like a subscription retention related campaign. When we again try to further deepen the, their engagement with the premium features and make sure they adopt all the key features that we have inside a premium. And we have some other kind of, you know, retargeting campaigns. One of them as like in this example, which is when somebody is like, when we see a lot of users who are, for example, opening a paywall and they are not making the transaction, just declining them, or they're showing some interest in a paywall, but they are not going forward with a purchase, we start sending them a lifecycle marketing communication in form of push notifications and emails, and giving them a like discounts and asking them to explaining them what is the value of a premium subscription and what they can get if they subscribe now. And just to add a little more nudge and motivation, we add them with a discount. So we don't kind of primarily start with a discount. We start to explain and then just link it to our main offer. And then when some cases we see there's like people don't subscribe, we start offering them with discount. So when someone clicks on, for example, this push notification, it's going to deep link to a paywall inside the app, or there's a like 50% discount on the premium plan. And we saw, again, pretty much good success with these lifecycle marketing campaigns. About like 6% conversion rate from these campaigns and 4% increase in our monthly recurring revenue. Going again forward to the next strategy.
Vahe, before we went on, I did actually have a question about for these. Is it, I guess, usual practice to discount? I know there's some debate over, you know, whether discounting is a good thing or not. And it's just, I'm curious to see how that kind of plays out in the B2C app world.
Yeah, so for our case, I mean, for our case, most of our subscriptions, which is about like 80% of our subscriptions, are happening within the first 48 hours.
Okay.
And the other like only 20% of subscriptions are happening the further life cycle of the user. So we want to capture as much subscriptions as possible during this early period, which is the first week or something, because as it goes forward, their intent to pay is going to decrease. And we don't kind of start immediately with a discount. We start to send them some push notifications and other communications to explain them what is the value. But it's like, then we see there's a lot of people who are not interested in making the purchase with a full price. We start sending them a, like a discounted offers, and which one is like, and one of them are here. And yeah, I mean, I think discounts, I mean, there's, again, as you mentioned, there's a debate about discounts. Maybe they can hurt you in a long term. But I think if you do it, if you measure what is the effect in both, you know, for your short-term revenue and long-term revenue, you kind of can mitigate the impact and see which ones are the most effective ones and which ones are kind of hurting your long-term revenue. It's kind of a depends on a product, but I think you can discount and you should discount, but it's like every product should understand like what method and which discount strategy works for them the best.
Okay. All right. Great. So I'll go ahead and advance on to three.
Sure.
Here.
Yeah. And this is similar to Yekaterina's the other point about raising the ceiling of your LTV. Earlier this year, we introduced a super expensive plan of subscription called DGen, which is $90 per month or about $800 per year, if I'm not mistaken. And how we come up with this idea, well, I mean, with this kind of strategy, there are like two parts of it. The first one was how we can increase our LTV. And the other part of like the decision behind this was like, we are doing a lot of interviews, user interviews, and also looking at our customers' data. So basically customers, people use our application to track their net worth. And we see there's a lot of people who are tracking millions of dollars of net worth. And we started to running some user interviews among these users. See, okay, are you interested, you know, to pay more for a certain features that we don't have in a premium? And we kind of started to having a discussions with these users. We run a lot of user interviews, we came up with some insights and started to develop features that are more requested from these high net worth individuals that are using our application. And then we created a few of these features and we packaged it under this expensive plan. We rolled out earlier this year, about like a few months ago. And so far we are seeing a, you know, good kind of a progress here. So far, we see like a 4% increase in our monthly recurring revenue after from this new package. But again, I mean, there is also some other ways that you can do it. I saw a lot of people, I mean, we also tried with add-ons. For example, you have a like a yearly subscription or whatever subscription, and we start selling you an add-ons. And it's like one-time purchases to access or some materials or some communities or whatever. In our case, we did a add-on strategy last year when we created a one-time purchase package, which includes our access to our paid newsletter and access to a VIP customer service when you could get your answers pretty quickly access to a special Discord channel where our research analysts were publishing some materials and the insights about what's happening in the investing industry and the crypto and stocks, whatever, and we package it as it as an add-on and started to sell on top of or like premium subscription, and we saw pretty much success there as well. So I think when you're trying to kind of optimize your LTV, there are like multiple things that you can do. One of them is just to try to introduce maybe like a higher packaging, a higher option, premium option, or kind of a try to play with add-ons and see what you can upsell and see how well that can work for you.
Yeah, I think CoinStat is very interesting because this is kind of more on the fintech side of things.
Yeah.
So you guys kind of had access to say, oh, these people, you know, probably have willingness to pay because they have a lot of investments and things like that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Would you, I guess, in another industry, draw maybe a parallel to doing that higher tier more for, say, like a power user, mm-hmm. perhaps?
Yeah, I didn't do a higher tier for another industry, but I did an add-on.
Okay.
I was consulting this social media management app, and they're like social media managers were using the app to plan their social media, build the content strategies, etc. And we came up with a like add-on strategy. We created a PDF ebook with like social media trends for 2024, mm-hmm. and we put a lot of insight in it, some suggestion how you can improve your Instagram, how you can make your feed, Instagram feed better, and some sort of, you know, very insightful and actionable feedback in the ebook. And we started selling it as a add-on to the premium users, and it really worked. It was not a like, it was a like one-time purchase to unlock your ebook, but it's like we saw there is an increase in the LTV, but it was not a like a, this is the, my only like kind of experience with adding a like higher purchasing tier,
okay,
for a you know subscription app.
All right, great. So I'll go ahead and four.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Okay. So we also did a lot of work in recovering churn revenue, and here I'm talking about involuntary churn when users didn't cancel their account, but there were like some technical issues, and we failed to charge them, and This is like mainly applicable for the like B2C apps that also have a web product as we do. So like Stripe, we use Stripe for billing, and Stripe kind of allows you to see, you know, when, for example, your customer's credit card is going to expire, or like helps you to like easily target them and ask them to upgrade their billing details. And every time when we see there is a, like a failed payment, when they log in the app, we show them like this proactive notifications. And so, you know, we failed to charge your credit card. You need to update your details now if you want to continue to use the service. And another very like a helpful tool here was this Stripe's feature that allows us to see when our customer's credit card is going to expire. And for example, if it's going to expire like in 2 days and the subscription renew is due in another week, we send them this like other proactive notification that says, you know, your credit card is going to expire soon. Please update your credit card details so we can charge you successfully. So we kind of started to send this sort of notifications to involuntary churn users or to users who were about to churn because of technical issues. And we see the 3x increase in the recovered revenue from churn subscribers. So another like big channel that we use for the upward revenue growth is the influencers. So we partner a lot of like key opinion leaders in the crypto industry, influencers, and we try to sign them up in our affiliate program. We work with them. And this was a pretty big success for us so far. Well, the mechanism, how it works, we didn't then kind of work with influencers to bring us new users. We work with them to bring us a new paid subscribers. And the way we do it, we create a conversion optimized landing page, and we personalize them for influencer. For example, we work with this like crypto banter influencer, and when somebody click and we give them a discount to share with their audience, and when somebody like clicks on their like unique link, it opens a, like a personalized landing page where people will see their influencer's logo, and like as seen on Crypto Banter, there's like 59% off for a Coinstar subscription for the first year. And this is like the one of the most important part here is like we do the discounts on the first year, and for the next billing cycle, it renews for the actual base price. So we saw like a very big success with this, from 200,000 new users to 30% increase in annual recurring revenue. And this is today is one of our biggest like a growth channels with working with influencers and key opinion leaders in industry.
All right, great. And I think we
and the other one, loyalty programs. I mean, loyalty program was also a pretty good revenue, was a pretty good revenue driver for us. We have this loyalty program in the app. When users do some certain actions, they collect virtual currencies and then exchange with some perks. And in our case, the perks are these mystery boxes. We have like four tiers of mystery boxes, and there is a like a crypto inside it. And to some probability, you also can win a like one Bitcoin or one some very expensive crypto coin. So what is required you to do to have the virtual currencies and to open one of these boxes, you need to refer premium users. So you refer someone who buys a premium subscription, you get, for example, 20,000 are virtual currencies, and then you use this 20,000 virtual currency to open a box and get a free crypto. And as I mentioned, this the crypto can also be to some possibility can be a Bitcoin or some other sort of very expensive coin. And we saw a lot of like actual people were like using this, trying to recruit kind of a premium members and use their like virtual currencies to exchange with these mystery boxes. And we are still optimizing this program and trying to make it better because we saw a big potential in it. But in general, this is a pretty good strategy for any subscription app to have this gamification component and try to utilize their user base to create this growth loop. It's going to people are gonna like deliver the word of mouth and get new users for you.
Okay, and on this viral referral loop, I am curious. I think you know it's always for. We get to this point where we have the screen and we're like, okay, well, we'll get people to refer users. Is mm-hmm. there anything that you guys did with experiments of going like beyond that step? Did you guys give ways to like send emails over to people or anything like that that kind of basically smoothed that process for, I guess, introing new people?
Yeah, we did. We did allow them to share an email, SMS, and whatever on their social media as they wanted to make it as seamless as possible. And we also had a personalized onboarding for the other hand. For example, if I refer you and you install CoinStats, when you go through the onboarding in the end, a pop-up opens and says, Fahed gave you X number of free crypto. Okay. If you collect 10,000 more, you will be able to open one of these boxes and you can win a Bitcoin. You know,
okay.
It's like trying to activate the other hand of the equation too. So you come up to CoinStats for the first time, you say, oh, you already have a balance. You are like halfway through, or you are some percentage way through. And you need to kind of find one or two other people who buy the premium, and you can get this virtual currencies and win a Bitcoin or some other sort of coin.
Okay.
So we kind of optimize the both ends of the equation here.
Great. So that's a really good way to think about it, is that it's not just the activation for your users who are sending the invite. It's also the activation for the users getting the invite. All right. So I think that wraps us up for all of those revenue levers. And I am very glad that we started there because we are getting to the top of the hour. So I do want to just go ahead and cover a couple of questions before the end of our session. We do have some from a couple of users. So opinions on blocking paywalls, basically, and making it mandatory that you have to put in credit cards in order to do trials and things like that. And Ekaterina, I'll let you start on this one.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, super multi-layered question. Honestly, I don't think there is a, personal opinion, I would not do that. In terms of, I can explain.
Yes, please.
However, this really depends on your product, obviously. Okay. So like the traditional answer, it depends. You need to make sure that the user's experience, like the value that they're getting, let's say that they get activated, that they can build a habit. Like I would start with making sure that users can do this first. And this typically calls for some kind of a freemium model, like some kind of a freemium offering. You can limit the consumption of content, or you can limit the amount of features. But having a hard paywall significantly blocks the ability of users to actually get the value out of your product. This in turn can really hamper your activation, retention rates. And if your product is in any way suitable for virality, it will also probably not enable the users to recommend your product to anyone else via word of mouth. So I would really think twice before doing that. I think like all of the things and like the way you monetize need to be tested. And it's really interesting to see if a hard paywall will in any way perform better than like a soft skippable one. But I just, I'm a huge believer in freemium, ideally freemium plus free trial kind of models, because these are the models that really help users experience the value of your product. And then they can decide if it's worth paying for it. So this is my take for now.
Okay. All right. And Vahe, your opinion?
Yeah, I mean, I overall agree with you, Katrina. The only case I think you want to do a hard paywall is when you have a huge cost associated with your product, and kind of keeping a freemium users are really costly for you. I was consulting some app, and they had a lot of issues with a cost because they were allowing users to store some files and et cetera, et cetera. And they were doing a mandatory free trial because for them, if somebody using the app for free and, hosting a lot of megabytes or gigabytes of information, it's going to be pretty much costly. I mean, you can try to kind of minimize the storage that the free users is getting, but in general, I mean, if you have a huge cost associated with your freemium use cases, you probably might want to limit the paywall. Limit to only free trial version or a paid version. But in general, if you do that, you're gonna hurt your virality. You're gonna hurt your word of mouth, and maybe it's probably going to hurt your growth overall.
All right, great, great. And just right before we hit the top of the hour, Ekaterina, a question for you on the MIMO paywall. Did you guys change some of the copy whenever you ran that experiment?
Was it the one with splitting into two parts, like the screen into two parts?
I believe. So. Yes.
Honestly, I don't remember. I don't know. I don't think so, though. Obviously, you have to. If suddenly instead of just we used to have for a really, really long time, this Blinkist style kind of paywall with the explanation of how the free trial works. So this was the one we were iterating over and over and over again. So over time, it has evolved, but it's still, and then we come up with the version where we also show the pro features before that. So of course the copy was different because you have the whole new screen on top of that. But apart from this, I don't think much has changed in terms of call to actions or copy.
Okay. And I do want to be respectful of everybody's time, but if we can get one more question in, we should be able to wrap this up just 5 minutes past the hour, if you guys don't mind. We have a great question here about having a high price versus lots of discounting versus just pricing lower. So is it better? Basically, I think what they're trying to get at is, does having a lower price with a higher number of premium subscribers correlate to having a larger word of mouth loop? Because I think a lot of what you and have both covered is that if you have blocking paywalls or things like that, it's going to hurt your referral loops and your word of mouth. So is there a balance to be struck there? Basically, does it does that discounting, I guess, kind of trick work better, or is it better just to have your pricing lower?
So discounting overall, I don't think I would necessarily use it as a growth strategy, let's say today. I had talked about it, and he also mentioned that in their lifecycle marketing campaigns, for example, they don't start with that, they don't lead with that. Right. From my experience, I can also say that once you employ this strategy, once you go into really aggressive discounting right away, it's really hard to get away from it because then it starts contributing to quite a significant part of your revenue early on because also, yeah, we have sometimes like really short conversion cycles, and most of the users like will convert within 1 week or two, like without the trial, for example. So it's very tempting to do that. At the same time, I do believe that it like it lowers your average revenue per user, obviously. It also hampers like the perception of your brand, because if your product is so good, why would you be offering a discount for it right away in such an aggressive manner? We do have a lot of competitors that really do this, I would say, pretty aggressively, because I do also think that they have to. My personal take is I would lower the prices, but I would also do both. I would try to approach it in a smarter way in terms of do offer discounts and do lower the prices for the audience, like for the segments that need it. This is a very classical example of that. You can differentiate, like discriminate the price based on the country like the users are based in, for example. For discounts, for example, it makes a lot of sense to see like how engaged the users are, like how many times they might have been exposed to the paywalls already, how much they're using the product. Because if they're using the product a lot and they have seen your paywall multiple times, then it might be the case that the price is the reason that blocks them from upgrading. Not always, but it might be. And in this case, offering a significant discount to just this part of the audience might be a revenue driver. It might still lower your averages, but you should like get in absolute numbers a little boost. Apart from this, I think lower price overall, in my opinion, could work better. But honestly, I never tried to compare both of this within one product.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Vahe, anything to add to that, to cap it off for us?
Oh, yeah, I mean, to be honest, I also never tried to experiment with lower price and high price plus a lot of discounts. But I think the answer, I mean, I think it depends really. And it's also very important to keep in mind that if you have a lower price, it is going to be a kind of a challenge for you if one of your growth models is the paid UA. Because if you have a $20 subscription, but if you are running a lot of paid ads, you're probably going to have a period about a big problem with your payback period and, you know, ROAS, et cetera, et cetera. The other hand, if you have a high price, when you are converting your users in a healthy rate and you offer some discounts and you, for example, do the discount only for the first billing cycle, and for the next billing, and you don't do a forever discounts, $20 forever when you are offering $60 per year subscription, but you do, $20 or $30 for the first year, but then you're going to renew them for the $60 for the next billing cycle. I think this also can be option. I mean, before deciding which one works for you, I think it's better to understand what are your objectives and also picking the strategy in the right way. Because both have their downsides and also they have their positive sides. And I think it kind of depends on your situation, and not only the situation, but how you're going to approach this, right? And yeah, I think that is the kind of the best or logical approach to it. But I think I personally never kind of experiment between these two to say, okay, for our case, this worked much more better.
Okay. All right. And I think it all comes back to, you've got to understand your growth models and understand how these experiments are all going to impact it. So with that, we will go ahead and wrap. Vahe, Ekaterina, thank you both so much for joining us. I think this was incredibly useful to see all of those case studies laid out. Where's the best place for our audience to connect with you guys? LinkedIn,
Twitter, both works.
Okay, and don't forget, you can always join Growth Mentor as a pro member and get one-to-one personalized calls with Vahe and Ekaterina and get it applied to your own B2C app. To all of our watchers, thank you so much for joining us today, and we hope you have a great rest of your day.
Thank you all. Thanks for the invite.
Thank you, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, everyone. Bye.